3 years before we cloned the first animal, Dolly the sheep, in 1996, we were forced to seriously consider bringing extinct animals back to Earth with the success of Jurassic Park. Now, the park is back online, so let's get back into the science. I have some good news and some bad news for you, so hold on to your butts. In the latest installment of the Jurassic Park series, Jurassic World, the park on Isla Nublar is finally fully operational, with thanks to genetics research that has come a long way in the intervening 22 years. Frog DNA is out and full genome replication is in. In the original Jurassic Park, we had mostly complete dino DNA with the help of DNA extracted from mosquitoes and ancient bugs trapped in amber, but in Jurassic World, we have full dino genomes apparently sequenced from dozens of different species. But let's start with what Jurassic World gets right. Thanks, dude. That night. Bringing extinct animals back to life is now a field of study called de-extinction. And Jurassic World is right. If we wanted to fully recreate a dinosaur, you would need a full genome or a nucleus that contained it. But there's a problem. DNA has a half-life like a radioactive material does, as half of it decays into another element over time. So every 521 years or so, the bonds that make up DNA's genetic blueprint decays into something unusable, even if it's trapped in an insect in amber. This half-life to DNA means that there is a hard limit on how far we can reach back into the past and pull organisms out of extinction. And unfortunately, 65 million years ago is well past that limit. Na 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 na. But can life find a way? De-extinction may be a fantasy for dinosaurs, but for other more recently extinct animals, there is real hope. And the poster child for this effort is, of course, the woolly mammoth. What you need is either a full mammoth genome, which we actually just finished sequencing, or a viable mammoth cell with a nucleus that has a genome already inside of it. Then you find a suitable egg cell like one from the mammoth's closest living ancestors, the elephants. Then you take the elephant's genetic material out of the egg and bop in the mammoth's. Then you coax this hybrid into dividing and place the developing embryo into a live elephant. Waiting would be the hardest part. We've actually tried this method before and brought an extinct animal back to life with the Pyrenean ibex. Of all the 57 embryos transplanted into ibex surrogates, only 7 took, and only one, nicknamed Celia, was brought back from extinction for 10 minutes. It died soon afterwards with malformed lungs. A mammoth embryo would have to gestate for a full 2 years inside of an elephant surrogate before we knew that the process was a success. And all of this tedium ignores the fact that we've never successfully harvested elephant egg cells before. It all sounds incredibly difficult because it is. But thanks to our leaps and bounds in genetics, we might have a mammoth back from the dead before the next Jurassic Park movie comes out. Then the next question would be, we can de-extinct animals, but should we? There is still one way we might be able to make a dinosaur though, by unlocking the genes turned off in modern day dinosaurs, the birds. Who knows, one day the scaly history of the chicken might unfurl like the wings that dinosaurs eventually got. I mean, we just gave a chicken embryo its teeth back by messing with its genes. Why make a chickenosaurus? Because science. Want more science? Check out my last video on the science of identical twins featuring the Sklar brothers. Subscribe to Nerdist for more videos if you want, because science 2 days earlier than anyone else, head to Vessel at vessel.com/Nerdist. And as always, if you have any comments or questions or suggestions for future episodes, hit me up in the comment section below. Thanks.